Buddy, it's a pleasure to have all of you here. It's good to see smiling faces and all of you here with us today. It is a beautiful day that the Lord has given us, and it is a day to sing praise and honor and glory to Him. Let us lift our love to Him. As we do so, let us begin with a word of prayer. Gracious Lord, You are holy, 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 worthy of all of our praise and honor and glory. And we ask, dear Lord, that You would help us to worship You in spirit and in truth, that You would be here to fill us with Your Holy Spirit so that it would lift our voices even higher, so that You would guide and direct and bless our worship of You. Dear Lord, we love You, and we ask for Your presence, and we trust in Your holy word, that wherever we are gathered together in Your name, You are there in our midst. And so we thank You, dear Lord, for being here with us and blessing our worship and blessing each and every one of us. And we thank You, dear Lord, for You are holy. In Jesus' gracious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke Your name into the night. Then through the darkness, Your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me His own. Beautiful Savior, I'm Yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the One who set me free.
Hallelujah. Its grip on me, You have broken every chain. There's salvation in Your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. The silence, the roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me. Oh Jesus, Yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the One who set me free.
So much for the work that you've done on the cross. We thank you that your work gives us hope. It gives us courage to stand in life circumstances, Lord. We're thankful this morning for the work that you've done and the work that you are doing in us, Lord. We thank you and we praise you, God.
Amen. You called out into darkness. You reached out to save us. You conquered the grave. You crossed the divide. Lost in our sin, you made us alive. How can we ever hold it in? We can't hold back. We're gonna lift you higher, higher. Hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, making louder, louder. We're never gonna stop singing. We're never gonna stop singing. Bound by chains, you rescued me and called me by name. You conquered the grave, you crossed the divide. Lost in our sin, you made us alive. How can we ever hold it in? Higher, higher, hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, make it louder, louder. We're never gonna stop singing. We're never gonna stop. Higher, higher, hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, make it louder, louder. We're never gonna stop singing. Never gonna stop singing. Every tribe, every tongue, every heart will sing. Every knee we will bow to the risen King. Lift him up, never gonna stop singing. Ooh, we're never gonna stop. Every tribe, every tongue, every heart will sing. Every knee we will bow to the risen King. Lift him up, we're never gonna stop singing. Ooh, we're never gonna stop. Higher, higher, hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, make it louder, louder. We're never gonna stop. Singing. We're never gonna stop. Higher. So much. You have chosen us by name. You have given us a calling in your kingdom, Lord, and there's no greater honor than to live for you, than to glorify you each and every day. So, Lord, give us the courage by your Holy Spirit to live a life worthy of your name. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we don't ever want to stop singing of your goodness, of your glory, of your holiness. We don't ever want to stop praising you. And everything that we do, we want it to be an act of worship. We want it to be a statement of how much we love you. We want every action we take to be a show of how much we love you. So as we turn now and open up your holy word, we ask that you see this, that we are doing this in love for you, to learn more about you, to grow in our faith and our understanding of you. So we ask you, dear Lord, as we open up your holy word, that you would open the words to our eyes and our hearts, that you would make us see you more clearly and love you more dearly. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning. It's so nice to see all of you. Today, we're going to be having a discussion out of the Old Testament, out of Genesis. Genesis 6 in particular, and it's a story that you might not have heard in a while because it's the story of Noah. It's the story of the Ark. And it's a story often told in Sunday school, right? This is what the children get to hear about. They get these old stories from the Old Testament, but we don't often cover them ourselves. And recently, when I was with the high schoolers, we talked about this. And that made me think for a little bit about the story for weeks after. And I pray that this happens with you guys too, that after any given Sunday that you hear a song, you hear a word, you hear a scripture, you hear something in the Bible and it sticks with you. And then a week, 2 weeks later, you're like, oh, I remember this. And you start thinking about it more. And this is the Spirit working on you. I pray that that happens to you because it happens to me all the time. And I think of something that happened a week or 2 weeks ago, and it just springs up. And I have to go back into the Word because I think, well, did it say this or this? I was unclear about this other thing. I got to go back into the Word to find out what it is, just to satisfy that. And I feel that that's the Holy Spirit leading me back into the Word, that specific verse and chapter. So we're going to read out of Genesis chapter 6. We're going to read one section. We're not going to read the whole story of Noah, but we're going to be reading one section, Genesis chapter 6. I'm going to start in verse 5 and go to the end of that chapter. And I'm going to be reading out of the New American Standard Bible. So it says, "Then the Lord saw the wickedness of mankind was great on the earth, and that every intent of their thoughts, of their hearts, was only evil continually. So the Lord was sorry that he had made mankind on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Then the Lord said, I will wipe out mankind whom I have created from the face of the land, mankind and animals as well, and crawling things and the birds of the sky. For I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. These are the records of the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah fathered three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in the sight of the Lord, and the earth was filled with violence. And God looked on the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for humanity had corrupted its way on the earth. Then God said to Noah, "The end of the humanity has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence because of the people, and behold, I am about to destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. You shall make the ark with compartments and cover it inside and out with pitch. This is how you shall make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, its width 50 cubits, and its height 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark and finish it to a cubit from the top and put the door on one side of the ark. You shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. Now behold, I myself am bringing a flood of water upon the earth to destroy all flesh in which there is the breath of life. From under heaven, everything that is on the earth shall perish. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall enter the ark, you, your sons, your wife, your sons' wives with you. And every living thing of all flesh you shall bring two of every kind into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female. Of the birds according to their kind, and of the animals according to their kind, and of the crawling things of the ground according to its kind. To every kind will come to you to keep them alive. As for you, take care of yourself. Take for yourself some food of every food that is edible, and gather it to yourself, and it shall be food for you and them." So Noah did these things according to everything God had commanded him. So he did. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. As I was reading through this, and actually as I was considering this and then went back to read through this, I had a question. Why an ark? Why did God have Noah build an ark? Presumably to save the animals. Noah's not going to make an ark that's 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. We had a great illustration that Mark did during the high school, middle school group of exactly how big this is and compared it to other ships. This is a huge freight line. This is a container ship kind of size of ship. This is a big boat. Why did God tell him to make an ark? He was going to destroy the world, all living things on it. He says in verse 7, "I will wipe out mankind whom I have created from the face of the land, mankind and animals as well, and crawling things and birds of the sky." There's only one thing not left on this list, right? The fish in the ocean. So he's going to wipe out everything that's on the face of the earth and above the face of the earth. Everything that crawls and walks and flies, all of these things, he's going to destroy completely. Everything that has the breath of life, he's going to kill. So why did he tell Noah to build an ark? We know why he was saving Noah. It says in verse 9 that Noah was righteous, blameless in his generation, and Noah walked with God. So out of all of the people on the world, God found Noah. Noah was blameless in his generation. He was a righteous man. He walked with God. So why would he save Noah? Because he's a righteous man and he walked with God. This is a person that's faithful amongst the corrupt peoples across the world. He found Noah. And he saved him because of this. So why an ark? It's too big for one family. Even with sons and sons' daughters, right? You don't need a container ship. You don't need a freight liner. You don't need a cruise ship for one family. So why an ark? The animals. The short answer is the animals. So we know why God saved Noah, and he told Noah, build an ark to save the animals. The next question is, why did he save the animals? Let's go back. Noah was a righteous man, so God saved him. Noah walked with God, so God saved him and extended that blessing to his family and your wife and your kids and their wives. Were the animals righteous? The animals walk with God? So why the animals? And the first response that I came up with is so that he can restart things, right? Two of every kind. Now, that doesn't mean that you're going to have horses and zebras and all of these other things that are related to one kind of animal. You have one kind. And I get that. So two of every one kind. And it says that God is going to send them to him. So two of every kind, and this is how God's going to restart the earth. The question is, does God have to do it that way? We've got animals there. And he's going to destroy everything. He says in the word, I'm going to wipe out mankind, animals, crawling things, birds of the sky. He's going to wipe them out completely. Did he have to have them come on the ark in order to save them? In order for us to have animals today? If we look back in Genesis, going about five chapters back to Genesis 1, verse 24, and the creation story that we find in the first chapter of Genesis, it says, then God said, let the earth produce living creatures according to their kind, livestock and crawling things and animals on the earth according to their kind. And it was so. God spoke that there would be animals of every kind, and it was so. And now he's having animals of every kind come onto the ark. If God spoke them into existence before, can he not speak them into existence again? He's going to save Noah and his family because Noah is righteous. So Noah, build a boat big enough for you and your family for about 40 days and 40 nights. And I'm going to save you and your family. And when the floodwaters recede, I will speak and there will be animals. It's in God's ability to do this. So why did he choose not to do that? Why did he choose to have Noah build an ark for two of every kind of animal? Before we answer that question, what God told Noah to do, specifically, because we're saying he told him to build an ark. First off, an ark is a huge ship. Mark corrected me if I'm wrong, because I'm trying to remember, but a cubit is the length from the fingertip to the elbow, is that right? So of an average person saying they didn't have the inch back then, a cubit was, and so it's an average estimate. The difference between one man and the next isn't too great. I mean, unless you're putting me against Mark or Phil or somebody or Sam, they've got much longer than ours. Their ship, 300 cubits, would be longer than my ship of 300 cubits. So he tells him, you shall make an ark. It shall be this long. You shall make a window. You shall put a door on top. This word shall means must, means you definitely will. This language means I'm telling you to do it, and I know that the reaction is going to be you're going to do it. It indicates a trust and a knowledge that what is spoken is going to happen. So God tells him, you shall do these things. And then he gives him instructions on how to build an ark. So let's back this up and look at it in order. First off, God decides to destroy all earth, all living creatures on earth. Second off, he finds Noah, a righteous man. And I'm not saying that he didn't see him before. Don't take my language to mean that God isn't all-knowing. God sees Noah, righteous man, decides to save him and his family. God then instructs Noah to build an ark. What's an ark? Well, build it this long and this big, and it's a boat. Why am I building a boat? He doesn't get there yet. As we read through this, God says to Noah, I'm going to save you and your family. And then he says, this is what I need you to do. Build an ark. It needs to be huge, three levels high, very long, very wide, very high. He doesn't say why. As we start in the scripture, he simply tells him, this is what you're going to do, and this is how you're going to do it. He gives him instructions before he gives him an explanation. Then afterwards, he says that he's going to bring all the animals. And they're going, oh, okay, this ark is to bring the animals. Okay, I get it now. The order is important. So when God goes to Noah, the first thing is he recognizes Noah. Noah is a righteous man. The next thing he does is he calls Noah. He speaks to Noah and calls him to do this thing. The next thing is he gives him instructions on how to do what it is God is calling him to do. And then third and lastly, the thing that isn't, I guess, written out word for word here is that God blessed Noah. We can read from the text about the blessing. First off, he's not going to die with the rest of the world. That's a blessing, right? The whole world is going to be destroyed. Me and my family were cool. You guys who have families, you know that if this happened, I'm going to destroy everything in the United States. But you and your family, I'm going to make sure that you get out alive. How many movies are there out there that are based on that premise? Destruction of the world, the end of the world, nuclear annihilation, however it might happen, but then there's this one family, and they make it out alive, and they persevere. So God says, I'm going to destroy everything, but you and your family, you're going to persevere. This is a blessing. The other blessing I see in here is God was doing a work, and he allowed, instructed, gave Noah the opportunity to be a part of the work that he was doing. We just established in Genesis 1:24 that God could have done it differently. God didn't need Noah to repopulate the world. God didn't need Noah to save all of the animals. He could have done it himself with the word. He spoke and they appeared of every kind. So God, instead of doing that, chose to bless Noah with the work of being a part of what he was doing, of this righteous work that God was doing. He said, Noah, you and your family, you're going to help in the work that is being done and ordained by God. This is a blessing. God brings Noah in and says, I'm going to do this thing, and now I'm going to make you a part of it. You're not just going to save your family. I'm going to make you a part of repopulating the entire world with animals. That's you, Noah. You get to do this. You get to do this incredibly important task. And this is the blessing that God gives to Noah. So two really important things off of this. Beyond the blessing of being kept alive when he's destroying the world, when God is destroying the world, Noah is blessed to be a part of the work that God is doing. Which leads me to the next question. Why? Has this ever happened anywhere else in the Bible? Has it ever happened anywhere else that God has brought men or women in and said, you are going to be a part of the work that I'm doing? Of course, if we look back in Genesis at the creation, he created everything. He didn't ask for anybody's help. He did it all himself. And then we find these stories over and over through the Bible. If we skip to the New Testament, we find a story of Jesus with his disciples, and they've got a crowd of people coming around him. And it comes dinner time. And it says in Matthew 14, now when it was evening, the disciples came to him. Matthew 14:15. Now when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, this place is secluded, and an hour has already passed to eat. So basically, it's past dinner time. Send the crowds away so they may go into the villages to buy food for themselves. But Jesus said to them, they do not need to go. You give them something to eat. Excuse me, us? Do you see the crowds? There's like 12 of us, Jesus. Do you see how many people out here? Apparently they counted later. It's around 5,000 people. 12 of us, you expect us to feed? I'm telling you guys, whenever we have an event and we have a lot of people come to church, we might get 100, 200, 300. We might get into the hundreds. And it's a task to feed everybody. And he's telling 12 to feed 5,000. He says, you feed them. So in verse 16, but Jesus said, they do not need to go. You give them something to eat. They said to him, we have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, bring them to me. And ordering the crowds to sit down on the grass, he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and he looked up toward heaven. He blessed the food, and breaking the loaves, he gave it to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they picked up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. There were about 5,000 men who ate, besides women and children. Did Jesus need the disciples to feed all these people? They came to Jesus and gave him the standard idea, a good option, I would think. It's like if we come together and we're having this event that I just talked about, and we're going to have hundreds of people, and we come together as a planning committee, and we talk about how are we going to feed them. And if we say we're going to have too many to feed them here, what do? There's places to eat. Send them out to places to eat. If it's going to be too many or we don't have enough time, go eat. We'll have a break. Send them out to eat, give them time to eat, and come back. That makes sense. So they gave Jesus an option that they thought made perfect sense. But Jesus was going to do something miraculous. Jesus could have simply created food to appear there on the ground. He did it before, correct? He made manna and provided quail when they were lost in the desert. We know that this is possible because God has did it. But okay, for those of us that are looking and saying, well, God, Jesus, would Jesus do this? Matthew 4, verses 3 and 4. This is when he's in the wilderness being tempted by the devil. And it says, the tempter came to him and said, you are the Son of God. Command that these stones become bread. So Jesus can do that. It is not beyond his power. Even going beyond the, well, we know that God is all-powerful and Jesus is God, so Jesus can do it. Scripture tells us specifically he could simply turn the stones into bread and they would have enough to eat. So why involve the disciples? They come to him and say, we have this problem. They need to be sent away. One option for Jesus is, no, don't worry about it. Sit down. There is food for them because all of the stones around them are now bread. He could have done that. But instead, he brings the disciples in and says, what do you have? What do you have to give? What do you have with you? And they explain, we have a few loaves of bread and a couple fish. Bring them here. Jesus works with his disciples, and he works with what they have, and he creates a miracle. A miracle that the disciples were a part of. Not because Jesus needed them, but because Jesus was blessing them. They were a part. Jesus made them a part of this miracle that we all know about when Jesus feeds the 5,000. And we acknowledge that Jesus did this. But what I want you to acknowledge is that Jesus used the disciples, called them to him. Give me what you have, and made them a part of the miracle that he was doing. We can find many other stories in the Bible of how God uses people in doing the work of his kingdom. And for me, this is a blessing. Am I right? For God to call you, specifically you, and say, I need you to do this. And to know that this, whatever he's calling you to do, is something that he has ordained and is good and a part of his plan for his kingdom. This is amazing. Jonah. Many other stories in the Bible about God using people. But did it end there? Does it end with the end of the Bible? Is and I don't mean Revelation because we know that's to come. Does it end there? Did God stop using his children to do his work and further his kingdom? Did God just decide not to use you? Sure, he used Noah, he used the disciples, he used Jonah, he used other prophets and judges. Sure, he used saints that we know about. But did he just choose not to use you? No. No, he wants to use you. Specifically you. For his kingdom, for his work. Look around your life. He wants to use you. And if you can't see where he wants to use you, pray. He gave directions to the disciples. He gave directions to Noah. He gave directions to many people throughout the Bible. Paul, Peter, Stephen. Seek him out and say, what do you want me to do today? God doesn't need an ark to repopulate the world. He gave Noah that chance. That blessing to be a part of this incredible thing that we still speak about today. He gave the disciples a chance to be a part of this miracle of feeding the 5,000 that we still talk about today. And you think, well, mine might not be that big. The Bible is written, we're not adding anything to it, so it might not be as big as what's in Scripture, but it is sincerely big to the kingdom of God and to the work that's being done in the people. It's huge. If I get to affect your lives And God has called me to do so. If I get to affect your lives and help you to increase your faith and help you to know God better, oh my gosh, this is such a blessing. That is amazing. That is incredible that God would use me. And most of you know me only as a pastor, but I know me as something much more. I see all of my faults and all of my failures and how unworthy I am and how flawed I am. I see all of this and I think God can use me to help people come to a saving grace with you. God can use me to do his work. Wow. God can use you to do his work. Look around for it. Pray. Don't be surprised when God speaks to you. Okay, be surprised when God speaks to you if you get surprised. Because it'll happen. I know because it's happened to me. It's happened to people I love and I know. It's happened to people throughout Scripture. God doesn't need you, but he wants you. He loves you. He chooses you to be a part of his work. Do you see that? Do you see how God wants you to be a part of what he's doing? Let us pray for that sight. Gracious Lord, we pray that you give us the vision to see how you want to use us for your kingdom. We pray that you would show each and every one of us how we are supposed to be at work. Give us clear direction. What is our arc? What is the thing that you want us to do for your kingdom? How are we to affect your world? How are you calling each and every one of us to spread your gospel and to help others as you lead us? Dear Lord, I pray that you make this an urgent call on the hearts of everyone here, that you make this a prayer that is on their lips every day, that when they wake up, they sing, "Holy, holy, holy are you, God, because you are holy and worthy to be praised." And they say, "Thank you, Lord, you have given me another breath and another day on this world. Thank you, Lord, because you have given me Jesus Christ as my Savior. Thank you, Lord, for you have forgiven me and set up a place for me in heaven. Thank you, Lord, because you are making it possible for me to be at work in your kingdom here today." Let that be their prayer every morning. Now show me, Lord. Every morning let us pray, "Now show me, Lord, how do you want me to be at work in your kingdom? Who do you want me to speak to? Who do you want me to help? What do you want me to do? Dear Lord, give me my ark. Give me my instructions so that I may follow them, for I want to be a part of your work, dear Lord." May that be our prayer every morning. And then give us the fire of your Spirit to go boldly forth and proclaim your good news and live out our faith, knowing that you shall make all things happen that you have ordained. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name, and I've been born again into a family. Your blood flows through my veins, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
One more time.
And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Thank you, God, because you have adopted us into your kingdom. You have given us a new life, an eternal life with you, in perfect peace with a perfect God. And Lord, we thank you because we are no longer a slave to all the sin in our life that has kept us in bondage for so many years. Lord, in your name, chains break. In your name, there is peace. There is comfort. There is joy when circumstances do not look peaceful, do not look joyful. Lord, you provide a way. You split the sea. And Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. And all that I am, I place into your loving hands. And I am yours. I am yours.
So far away, when we feel so distant, Lord, let us constantly remember that we're yours.
Amen.
Worthy of
every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath that we could ever breathe. We live for you. My eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath that we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Upon your love.
Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Lord God, we thank you because you are a firm foundation. In this world, nothing can be trusted. Everything is moving. Everything is never the same. But Lord, you are the rock who is never changing. You are the holy and perfect one. And Lord, mold us into your image, no matter the cost, God. Sometimes we pray and we just want things that we want. We don't want the sacrifice. But Lord, you did not withhold your own perfect and holy Son for us. So let us not withhold our fleeting lives. Let us not withhold an ounce of them. But let us give our all to you, no matter the cost. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. As we prepare to pass around the offering plate, let us take a moment to go to our Lord in prayer. Lord, you are such a gracious and loving Lord, and you are righteous and holy, and you have blessed us beyond anything that we deserve, and you continue to bless us. And so we ask, dear Lord, that you receive these, our tithes and our offerings, as a thank you and with a grateful heart for all that you give us, knowing that everything that we have is yours and it comes from you. We return this offering or this tithe to you with hearts full of joy and thanksgiving. Bless it and use it for your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to skip the announcements, but I want to instead go to something else. I want to tell you the end of the story. Remember we were talking about Noah? The end of the story of Noah. It's the reason that we have a rainbow. That is a reminder of this story. That's how big it was that God allowed Noah to be a part of. That rainbow reminds us that God will never destroy the world by flood again. And I want to read to you at the end. Noah builds the ark, of course. The floods come, lifts up the boat, lasts for 40 days and 40 nights, starts to recede. The boat comes back onto dry land and they exit onto dry land. And then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and taking some of all the clean animals and clean birds, he sacrificed burnt offerings on it. The Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart, "Never again will I curse the ground because of humans," even though Every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood, and never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. Noah built an altar and made an offering, and it was pleasing to the Lord. I want to remind us all that it wasn't because of the clean animals, it wasn't because the location of the altar, it wasn't because what the altar was made of, it wasn't because the order in which he did it. It was because it was from Noah, and it was an act of love for God, that it was pleasing to the Lord. Let us remember that as we go forth this week, that we should make our lives an offering to the Lord, full of thanksgiving and joy, so that he will see us and we would be pleasing to him. Go now with his peace, go with his comfort, go with his grace. Go now knowing that the Lord of all creation goes with you, and he will uphold you, and he will protect you, and he will guide and direct you. Go now knowing that his fire of his Holy Spirit burns brightly in you, so that all will see you and hear your words and see your deeds and give glory to God in heaven. May his work for his kingdom be forever and ever. Amen. Have a blessed week, everyone.
I will trust in you and know that you are with me forever. I'll confide in you, 'cause you're the only answer that matters. Even in the darkness, you will be my light. Shaking.